Hello, I'm Danny Duran, and this is the Infinite Jigsaw podcast, a place for honest conversation, discovery, and with a genuine incentive to improve sense-making. In today's episode, I'm very pleased to be joined by Aziz Ibrahim. Aziz is a guitarist and composer and founder of the Desi Guitar and the Asian Blues, and as well as being a solo digital artist, Aziz is also well-known for his role as lead guitar for Simply Red and the Stone Roses, and several internationally acclaimed bands and artists, including Ian Brown, Paul Weller, Stephen Wilson, Asia, Rebel MC, and Errol Brown. His solo works include his acclaimed album, telling the story of his family's journey from Lahore to Longsight, the EP Middle Road, and album Rusholme Rock. Aziz is a passionate supporter of music education initiatives. The British Council selected him to tour and lecture in Libya, Syria, Tunisia, Morocco, Jerusalem, India, Pakistan and Bangladesh for several years, performing live and delivering lectures to young people and students from universities and colleges. And he carries on this work with a commitment to social responsibility, including guitar lessons and mentoring for prisoners and providing music therapy for hospice patients and also mentoring young people. Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth recognised his contributions to Great Britain's culture and the music industry in a ceremony at Buckingham Palace in 2005, along with Brian May, Jeff Beck, the Bee Gees, and many others. And after working closely with the University of Salford in 2018, Aziz was awarded an honorary Doctor of Arts in recognition of his work in music, culture, equality, and as a role model to many working class young people from disadvantaged backgrounds. Aziz, welcome to the podcast.
How are you doing, Danny? Okay.
Yeah, pretty good, thank you. Pretty good. That is quite some track record. I think there's about 100 podcasts in the description of that rich career you've made for yourself there.
Well, I think, you know, if we all started listing everything we've done in our lives, you realise how much work you've actually done. But until you actually write it all down.
Well, let me ask you something about your family history to kick off, because sure. You express that history in your work, what with the album Lahore To Longsight, which came out about 20 years ago now. But what drew you to articulate your roots in this way and make the album?
I think I kind of overdid it, really. You know, with the it's almost like wearing your hat on a sleeve kind of thing. You know, that's I think just because of the early days of being stereotypes and generalizations, and that made me probably project more about my identity and culture than I would have wished, but it's just the nature of life. I was born in the 60s and later of life in the 70s and so on, that, you know, discrimination was in a high, and I was kind of anger driven, but I tried to turn anger into positivity, you know, by positive results, shall we say. But I did project that kind of thing about myself, about, you know, where my parents are from and where I'm from and my language, and but also at the same time being Mancunian and, you know, looking for equal recognition. And I think that always has been the point throughout my kind of journey, is about just equality, really. You know, that word, I know it gets bandied around a lot, but It was always about equality and being treated as an equal. And as you can see, it crops up everywhere in the music, in the works, in the lyrics, in the influences of the music that I write, composition wise, and the people that I work with as well, because I'm always trying to promote other artists from various diverse cultures.
So were your parents one of the first wave of Pakistani immigrants to the Northwest?
Well, I mean, you see that in itself, historically, you could look back at the waves of immigration, and it goes back centuries and centuries, way back. It's just that was one of the, probably, yeah, the 50s and 60s were major kind of immigration times, obviously after the Second World War, and the male population, white male population here in the UK was very low, obviously, through deaths. And that migration Yeah, my parents were a part of that migration. My father was in the army, in the Indian Army, or it was the British Army at the time. And he retrained as a telecoms operator for the Reuters organization. And he came over and got a job in Manchester through a friend at the Evening News, Guardian. Well, at the Reuters organization on Deansgate, where they... Manchester Evening News and Sunday People, all the papers were, and Thompson House further up. So that's how he came to be here in Manchester. I was born in Longsight, but he originally lived in Mosside.
All right. And did you grow up then in your early formative years with a feeling of otherness due to the sort of nationality of your parents versus sort of your nationality?
A different experience, really, because my father's experience was that kind of, you know, no blacks, no dogs, no Irish, that kind of thing. And, you know, finding a place to live and finding other people from a similar background that they could share, or, you know, like feeding yourself and clothing yourself, housing and stuff was a real issue for them. Whereas my issues growing up were different. You know, there were school issues about bullying and racism at school and gangs. And you know, we moved house from the terrace house we used to live on, and I moved to the council estate, the Anson and Longsight, and there was the, you know, the do's and don'ts and the dangers of that and growing up there. But because I was born here, you know, obviously from day one, I was becoming accustomed to it. But also growing with that whole thing about, you know, the National Front marching through Longsight and standing up for yourself eventually, because there comes a point where you, you know, you just, you can't, you know, there's running away doesn't do you any good. You've got to stand up. And that's what it's like these days, you know, a lot of stand up people. But it was different in those days, you know, earlier decades, but there was a lot of changes went on. But as I said, my experiences are different to my father's. I grew up with, you know, exposure to the music through school and friends and my next door neighbor, and, you know, vinyl and cassettes and so forth. So whereas my father stuck to the what he grew up with and his traditions, and my mother the same, you know. So similarities, but not really, because, you know, second generation here is an experience in itself, if you get what I mean.
I do get what you mean, yeah. I mean, Longsight in the 70s and 80s, what was the type of music surrounding you in these formative years?
The experiences were different. I mean, you look at, if you spoke to, say, like Peter Hook or any of the guys from New Order or so forth, you know, they're Salford working class experiences and probably different to, well, similarities, but there were differences for, say, like an ethnic minority working class experience in Longsight. But musically, there were all these pockets emerging from different areas, and Longsight had its thing, as did Salford and other places, you know, Presswich, wherever, you know, like, say, Marky Smith and but for me, I had my, you know, my early experiences were more about discovering the guitar. So hearing my school teacher playing a guitar in primary school after a free bottle of milk. And then I was just mesmerized by this silver string thing. And that was the beginning of, you could call it the beginning of the end in a sense, for some people's opinions, but, yeah, it began there at primary school, St. Agnes Primary School, walking distance from my house. You know, the house where we're at now. I still live in Longsight on the same estate. But the guitar was the first thing. That was my first musical experience in a sense. And then there was a reel-to-reel at home, which we kind of inherited by the people who'd moved out. And on it was songs like Summertime Blues and That'll Be the Day. So it was all like Eddie Cochran, Buddy Holly, and, Elvis. And so I kind of grew up as like the first, almost first Pakistani rockabilly in the country or something. Maybe. Yeah.
And what about your mum and dad? Were they always supportive of your like fledgling music or career, and then later on your sort of dedication to music? Or did they want you to sort of get a proper job, as many parents of that generation might have said?
Yeah, absolutely. They wanted me to get a proper job always, even to this very day. And my mum's still alive. My dad passed away in 2006, God bless him. But yeah, it was always that, always. It's never changed. In the early days, you know, don't get me wrong, they were always supportive. They've been fantastic. I've been fortunate and blessed with loving parents and supportive parents, understanding ones. I've been very fortunate. You know, I understand, you know, that you're lucky when you have that situation. So despite the fact that they didn't want me to be a musician, they didn't know. I mean, it crept up gradually. You know, I never stopped studying on it. And it was just that one day, like in 1987, when I joined Simply Red, that was the shock, because the money they were offering and the world tour and the the kind of level which I was living at with them was just, it was too much to handle for the working class, came from villages in Pakistan, India, and then all of a sudden there's this rock stardom thing.
Had a plan for you, but they didn't foresee that.
Yeah, they never saw that. I mean, they have those stars in India and so forth, but we've never had a South Asian musician succeeding, well, in music, for instance, in the West, crossing over into the mainstream. So it was a real shock for them, a real shock. And not a shock for me, because, like I said, I'm born here. So I just grew up with it, and I grew up with the struggle for recognition and people, you know, acknowledging that I can play, and you know, or want to work with me, or that kind of thing. So, yeah, I mean, I feel sorry for them in a sense, because it must have been overwhelming and too much to handle. And then seeing pictures and, like, you know, whatever, and videos and stuff, and you're here and there, and then the neighbours are gossiping. Oh, we saw him with these girls or something, and blah blah blah, and they're thinking about arranged marriages. You know, they're still in that old school train of thought about, you know, we're going to arrange my marriage. So it must have been quite a shock for them. Me, it was testing, you know, it was a culture shock as well, because I was confronted with situations which you don't normally have to face when you're safe in your community and at the mosque, and, you know, keeping yourself to yourself or keeping within your community, which I've never really been that kind of person. I've always ventured out.
I was going to ask you, I mean, if you didn't venture out alongside, then you wouldn't have come across the members of Simply Red. I mean, how did that thing come about? Did you know Mick Hucknall? I mean,
the venturing out wasn't about meeting them. The venturing out was about playing in any band that asked me to play, and just generally enjoying playing music because people wanted to work with you. And then, you know, when I finished my work or whatever, my homework and all that kind of stuff, and, you know, I'd be out in the evening going to play. But it was kind of 50-50, because I was crazy about basketball and rugby and cricket and football and so at school. But basketball was my main sport, and I split my time between those two things, music and the basketball. And I know that sounds a bit strange, but again, you know, it's the atypical choices. It's just been my way that I'm testing new grounds of, like, kind of South Asian person succeeding in on those areas where, you know, we don't see many of our faces, like in football today, you know. But I kind of went there with basketball because I didn't know how far I could go. But the music just suddenly took off, because that phone call just came one day from Simply Red management, and it was an offer to join the group and offering me loads of money and travel and first class and blah blah blah. And I was just kind of like, you know, at first I thought it was a joke. I thought it was a friend. But then after that, when it, you know, the realization dawned on me, I kind of, you know, knew that my life was changing, was going to change. And it did come as a shock. But at the end of the day, I paid my dues. And, like, the recommendation came to them in the office of who's the guy, the go-to guy in Manchester, who's loves reggae and the Rolling Stones, or Keith Richards, that kind of stuff. I mean, that was Mick Hucknall's kind of aim, was that kind of combination of things that he wanted from a guitarist, I think. And I was in reggae bands for about 10 years, you know, learning from the great reggae musicians and bands from Mossad and Hume and Roundabouts, just playing and learning from them and being told, you know, what's wrong, what's right. So I'd already had the grounding, shall we say, in reggae music. And a lot of people don't know that because that's not what's publicized. You know, the plagiarism of the press really it boils down to one word or a couple of words or Manchester music or, you know, certain key bands. But in actual fact, I paid my dues playing reggae and dub and ska and so forth and in Manchester for many years. A name got about, and then this phone call just happened because they asked around, and that was it.
Perfect. Obviously, you got there through not only getting yourself out and about, but through your natural skill and the skill that you worked on and developed. And these were the days of manual listening, as I call it, of vinyl and tapes and things like that. And
wearing out the vinyl.
Yeah, and you had to tinker with things. It was a manual activity. I'd like to ask you something about this because It's kind of close to my heart. I mean, I sit here now in my small little podcast studio, come library, come kind of music den, where I've got a turntable, a tape deck, a CD player, and I've got records and tapes and CDs, and surrounded by these kind of relics from my past. I feel that I was quite lucky actually to have come up in a generation where listening was what I call a manual activity. You know, you had to tune into the radio or watch the telly to get wind of a good track. Then you had to plan a trip into town and make sure you had the cash to buy the record or the tape and later on the CD. And sometimes the shop might run out of what you wanted to order. So you had to plan to come back the next Saturday and get it and whatever. And then you get the thing home finally. You have to load it into or onto your hi-fi, your stereo, which, by the way, is your pride and joy. It's in the middle of your room and you're dusting it all the time. And only then could you get the full pleasure of your purchase. Whereas today, you flick aimlessly through YouTube, and if you like something, you turn it up and you're off. You know, no artwork to look at, no stacks of records to curate and sort out, no stereo to take pride of and dust. So do you get a sense, like I do, of how lucky we were and how much more magic it all was back in the days of kind of manual listening?
Well, I mean, it depends how you look at it, because, I mean, the gifts of today, how young people enjoy their pursuits today, I wish I'd had those, you know, when I was young, in my teens and so forth, or in my youth. You know, I wish I had those things so that I could access more things and get the information I wanted. But you're right in the respect that it's the old philosophy of no pain, no gain. And what we're talking about is the pain you experience in accumulating knowledge. Mm. You appreciate that knowledge because it was hard earned. And it's a difficult one to explain if you never experienced no pain, no gain. But it's the same in education. You know, if I wanted to know something, I was at a school that, you know, in sciences, we were on Nuffield and JMB after that. So it's not like today's education system. So it was all questions and no answers. So you had to go to the library to find the answers. And that was a case of, as you said, leaving the house, walking to the bus stop, getting this bus into city centre, going to the central library, getting the right floor, going up these wheelie step ladders to get to the right shelf, pulling down a book, getting the information, writing it down, and then doing that same journey home in reverse. So, you know, to acquire knowledge, there was a price, you know, and it's just something you had to do. And I think maybe that is a difference, you know, in the respect of, you really kind of appreciated what you had because it was like gold dust. You know, if somebody taught me a chord or a melody or something, a guy, say, or a woman who was more advanced than I was at that time, you know, and they'd share a little pearl of wisdom. And that was like, it was exactly that, a pearl to me, you know, just a priceless piece of knowledge. You know, entertaining yourself was, in that era for me, was, know, building a go-kart or something, and you had to go to the tip to go and find some pram wheels and finding a piece of rope and, you know, a crate and things like that, and making something to entertain yourself with. But, I mean, I don't mean to put down young people today, because they have their, it's a different set of problems or a different set of incentives and interests. But there is something to be said about that. I think that I think about what I've learned. It has come from hard work to actually find the knowledge instead of sitting there like now. If I want to know how to do something, I'll just go to YouTube. I'll use Google, or I'll use some kind of, you know, search engine to find what I want. And I can find copious amounts of information on what I want to do. I mean, it's like when I joined the Stone Roses. I wish I'd had the internet at its state now to be able to just search all the information I needed for the sounds I needed and the songs I needed to do and what key, and all the information from their tours and watching loads of videos. I could have done the work in a few days, let alone a week or so. But because I'd learned the old school way of putting my ear to the, you know, speaker, putting the vinyl on, playing a song, working out for myself where the notes are, finding the chords, and then putting the record on again. So my ears became trained. You know, I trained my ears to hear chords, to hear what kind of instrument it is, to hear what kind of, where the capo is on the guitar, what key it's in. You know, my ears can recognize, and plus I've got a memory of so many albums now that when I hear people play, I kind of go, you got that from such and such an artist, of such and such an album, of this song, and you played, you've learned to play his, what, that solo from that song. You know, I can actually recognize notes and chords and songs from where people have learnt them from. That's how much my ears become trained. So, you know, it's like joining in, improvising has become like my forte or second nature, improvisation. And I think my life is actually about improvisation, how I improvise through life. And I think that's how it is, don't you? Don't you think that you kind of accumulate knowledge in whatever field you're in, whatever area you're in, but you have to apply knowledge. And I think improvisation is a skill set in how to apply the skills that you've got very quickly. And it comes from like being stopped in the streets by the coppers. And you're going, it wasn't me. You know, you got to improvise. Come up with an alibi or something.
An alibi, yeah.
Yeah. And because you've been nicking lead off roofs or things. But yeah, so improvisation, I think, is a skill set that I've accumulated from that era and from my learning periods. And I'm still learning now, but I'm just saying from that period where knowledge was scarce and you really had to work hard to find just little bits of information. But they're so hard earned, and I respect that way that I got it, that, you know, it is that no pain, no gain, and I feel the pain as you probably did.
Yeah, you're right on. And I want to talk to you about sort of what comes through that process of research in terms of songwriting. But you mentioned the Roses, Stone Roses there. And I wondered if joining the Stone Roses came about in much the same way as joining Simply Red. Did they just know you as a proficient person that could do what they needed to be done?
No, it was a different thing. It was the when you have a mate on the inside thing. So at that time, there was a new drummer and keyboard player in the band. Robbie J was the new drummer and Nigel Lipperson was the keyboard player. And they were both friends of mine from my Errol Brown era when I was a musical director for Errol Brown. And Robbie was the drummer and Nigel was a keyboard player. So I'd known them. But at that time, when John had left, John Squire had left. Or rather, it wasn't known that he'd left, but he was missing in action, let's say. So they wanted to demo new songs that they'd written. That's all I knew at the time. So Robbie had asked me to come in and help with demoing the songs, playing guitar, really. So to me, it was just like, yeah, sure, of course I'll help you play some guitar for you and you can get your songs together. And that's how that introduction came about to, at that time, it was only Ian and Manny. Obviously, John not being there and Rennie had left previously. So it was a little while after that that it became clear to them that John wasn't coming back. And then the hunt for a new guitarist was on because they wanted to fulfill their festival dates, which was about five of. And then Robbie had rang me and said, you know, would you be interested? So that's how it came about. But it was through getting to know Ian and Manny, really, I think, after that, you know, did we get on while I was doing these demos? And we did. We did get on. And I lived in Longsight, and it's part of the lyrics, you know. This is the daybreak. So so it just kind of was natural. There were other people they were considering, you know, but I think that was more to do with kind of the relationship between them and John and obviously the hurt and the anger and so forth. Hello.
Chipper, do you mind? Sorry about that.
That's all right.
Chipper's trying to get in on the act. Yeah. Were you a fan of John Squire's guitar parts before? I mean, because you had to learn a lot.
Actually, no. I mean, you know, that respect came later, because when I started to learn the material and learn, you know, what I needed to play, that's where the respect began. Because when I delved into it deeply, the depth of it was kind of overwhelming in areas where I hadn't really ventured at all, because I hadn't had that opportunity in different ways. So that's where it began. Prior to that, I didn't really know the Roses tunes. I knew one tune probably, or a couple tunes. You know, I knew Fool's Gold because of the dance element and the breakbeat, you know, from a Motown tune and so forth. And some people that were involved. So it didn't really cross paths at that time, you know, because of what I was listening to. But then this education began, this music education. And that's when the respect began, because I was like exploring each song and this chord structures and the song structure and the sounds of the instruments and what was used and how the sound was put together. And when you start to delve into somebody's psyche, in a sense, and, you know, how they put this together, and then, yeah, obviously, you know, that respect began. More so for that first album than the second album for me personally. Just because the second album was easier for me to kind of understand, because it had those elements of Led Zepp and Jimmy Page and so forth in it, and more rock orientated, which was easy for me because I grew up with that element of, you know, teaching myself guitar from bands like that and learning all those Led Zepp albums and so on.
I mean, these are two class acts, aren't they, to follow. John Squire, you're emulating him, and your friend on the drums emulating Rennie. I mean, it's two class acts and two very individual players.
I mean, I don't think Robbie took that approach. I think he just did his own thing.
All right.
because he is, you know, who he is, and a great player. But I personally, because the guitar has so many colours, that I felt I couldn't do that. You know, I've only just joined the band. And I'm not just going to go, hey, I'm going to do what I want to do, because I've been invited in by the band, and also the audience, or let's say more importantly, the audience want to hear the songs. But the difficulty, now, a lot of people don't realize this, but I was caught between two worlds. The one world is, it's like when a person goes to see a covers band. They want to hear the albums exactly as they are, as they were recorded. That's what they want to hear. Yeah. But the other side of the coin is that a band gets older, they move on, they get other equipment, and they sound changes, and or they just you know, maturity or whatever it is, they're maturing as players, they become a different sound. And you can see that transition from the first album to the second album. So the band was at that stage where they had a rockier sound, but I knew fans wanted to hear the sound the way it was on the first album. So I was caught in a rock and a hard place, really, because I wanted to play it the way it was originally played on the albums, but the band were playing as a rock band, in a sense, you know, more contemporary, shall we say, to that first album. And if they wanted me to play in that kind of style, so I had to go with what, you know, the band wanted to do. So in a sense, yeah, there was that kind of clash of two different styles going on of where the band began and where it was at present at that time. So, you know, I just went with the flow, really, and played it according to, if you went to see, I mean, a good example would be if you went to see the Stone Roses in 1995 on tour, that was the sound that I was reproducing. So it'd been 1959, Gibson Les Paul, Marshalls and Fenders, and that kind of second coming era sound, that's where the band were at. But in the same sense, I kind of felt that I thought it needed to be played the way the first album was recorded. But there you go. What is it?
It seems like you threw yourself into it, quite, almost like an intellectual kind of ride for you there.
I can't help it. It's you know, it's the analyst in me. I love analyzing music.
You were the man for the job.
Well, I don't know. I think personally that because I was a bit too schooled. I mean, if I'm going to self-criticize myself, it was kind of, I'm too schooled, and you can't turn that back. You know, you can't reverse engineer, you know, and get back to naivety. And you need a certain level of naivety in the playing to let the soul, the honesty of your, you know, youth and instrument come together, and courage to be yourself. But schooling can sometimes overpower music, and you lose those elements. And there's one thing I have kind of analyzed only because I'm so interested in the differences between East and West and mindset and mentality of how the mindsets work and how we differ in trains of thought, respect systems, peer systems, religion, so many factors spiritually. And that freedom that I've always admired and envied in white culture in the UK, you know, like in the punk movement, I've always wanted that, but I've never been like that because of my lifestyle and the peer systems that I was born into. But in music, it's prevalent, especially if you like, you know, listening to the Sex Pistols or the Buzzcocks or Sham 69 or something, or, you know, that element of freedom and rebellion, it's something to be celebrated in itself, you know. I love that quote from Easy Rider, you know, that we just want to be free, we just want to be, you know, stick finger up to the man and ride our bikes and, you know, we just want to party. And, you know, there's a lot to be said in that, you know, those freedoms. And it's relevant today because I see freedoms being eroded, freedoms being taken away, or complacency, letting go of freedoms and not realizing how kind of hard-earned freedom is and what it gives you, and especially in music. And it was, but I like the shift because, I mean, it's still there, but sometimes it goes into a different genre of music, like hip-hop, for instance. You know, nobody knew hip-hop was going to be so big and conquer the world. It was, you know, people in hip-hop were being put down, you know, by schooled players, who's saying that's not real music and that's not real this and that. In actual fact, it was the music and where music went, and those freedoms and rebellion and revolution and, you know, freedom of speech and so forth. But just coming back to this, sorry, I know I've drifted away from what I was saying, but I believe in those things because I envy those things. And I always felt the Roses came from that. you know, from that punk era and the alternative and so forth. And or goth even, you know, it's early days of Roses, you know. And I envy that. And that combination of that naivety and youth combined with creativity is a winning combination. You know, you can't beat that. No matter how much you train and practice, you can never beat that. And I just enjoyed studying it, learning it, and analyzing it. It's all I could do, you know,
yeah.
And work on my own creativity and learn from that experience with the Roses about sound and so forth, and why this is far better than that, and or rather why, how it affects people, why people, catch on to something and it becomes kind of ingrained in them. And, you know, they're the things that I learned. And yes, like I said, I was kind of overanalyzing things, but I really wanted to get to the core of things and understand these differences and where I was going wrong sometimes, you know. And I'm glad, because it stopped me going down the wrong path as far as I'm concerned, you know.
Well, it's interesting that you allude to freedom there. And let me ask you about freedom of expression. And what I really see is kind of the lifeblood, or we might say the oxygen, of the creative person, whether they be a musician or, I don't know, a painter, a writer, a director, so on. Mm. And that is this freedom of expression, or maybe in other words, you could say something like the grace to make whatever art you want to in the way that you are moved to make it at that time without any constraints whatsoever. I mean, you've worked closely with Ian Brown, right? And I can't imagine Ian taking kindly to being told his music has to sound a certain way, or he can't use this or that lyric. I don't think that would fly with him.
Yeah, never. I mean, I learned so much from Ian on the first album we did together, Unfinished Monkey Business, his debut album. And watching him work, you know, I was gobsmacked. I mean, I was sticking numbers on frets and on keys, you know, in an ordered numbering system. So that he knew where his fingers were going, which notes he was going to play. I mean, that's what I'm saying about going from that kind of naivety, but the creativity part of him, you know, the vision and the uninhibited creativity was fantastic. And I saw the sense of it. It dawned on me then, you know. I mean, I've had the privilege of working with the Stone Roses, with the Smiths, or the rhythm section of the Smiths, with Paul Weller and other members around him, from the Style Council, and from all those camps, you know, as almost like a sober observer, internal observer, traveling with them, that it dawned on me in each occasion and woke me up and changed me for life. You know, I was just gobsmacked and realized how much I'd gone, almost, I won't say in the wrong direction, but that there was a world to discover, and I had a lot of work to do. And all, each came from these artists, you know, all very pragmatic, very charismatic artists who have defined, you know, British music. And affected the globe, you know, internationally. They've reached across continents. I was kind of learning from it. Maybe I didn't learn everything, but I picked up something valuable from it, shall we say, from each occasion. And then that it helps me shape my writing and creativity, not necessarily just music. Like I wrote this symphony for the Magister Camerata. I call it a symphony, but it probably isn't one, but I had to look the word up. And but being musically illiterate and only having a trained ear, I kind of wrote these compositions, converted them into, you know, musical staves, and, you know, through some software, Sibelius, and wrote this complete performance for the Magister Camerata at Home Theatre in Manchester. It was a sellout show. But those challenges, they come from those strengths that I'd learned from those guys. and not being afraid to be myself and make mistakes mainly. Because mistakes, I mean, it's said often enough that, you know, mistakes are the best part of the education for anybody. That's, you know, you're supposed to correct your, well, not maybe not correct your mistakes, but learn from your mistakes. You know? And mistakes, sometimes people call human nature mistakes, you know, little idiosyncratic little things that you do, or the things that make you human. They're not mistakes. They are a part of being human. And I think art is a reflection of being human, no matter what the medium. And I think if you start to iron out those little creases and iron out all the little unpredictable movements or thought processes, that's when music get, or art gets sterile. But when you leave it in there, you know, for the whole world to see, bearing your soul, that's when you relate to people. That's when you really relate to people globally. And I think the people who have had the most impact have been those kind of artists. And I'm not talking about the machinery that sells people. I'm not talking about the great advertisers and marketing and promotion people in the world. I'm saying the honesty of an artist, it sells itself if it can reach people, you know, through virally. I think that's probably the most valuable lesson I've ever learned.
Yeah, and it's one that we can all sort of transpose into our lives, into all our lives and our work and our relationships, that of kind of interacting with the sensation of being wrong and the sensation of making mistakes. And you were talking there about the kind of top-notch roll call of people that you have worked with. And I'd like to get your thoughts on an experience that kind of sets you and these other people that you speak of apart from the average person. It's something that only very, very few people experience in their lifetime. And that is the feeling of live performance in front of a huge crowd. And I'm really interested to learn about the energy that must be literally at your feet when performing on stage at a concert. I mean, does it evoke a kind of physical sensation? How does the body and the mind manage that level of directed energy?
Well, I mean, you got to bear in mind that when I'm performing, you know, I'm always sober as a judge. You know, I have you know, no alcohol has ever passed these lips, right, apart from on the lips of women, shall we say. That's the only time. But no, I wouldn't say that. What I do know is that when I've been on stage, that is the time when I really feel alive. It's that moment you get to do what you do, what you've spent all your time, all your life preparing for or training for, or, you know, you've accumulated all this knowledge and experience and then to put it into practice. But I actually like the kind of, I mean, I love it. I absolutely love live performance, but I love the Frank Zappa type of live performance. I love his philosophy to live performance. And, you know, why would you want every show to be the same? I don't do shows if they're my own shows. I never write down a set list because I don't know what I'm going to play. I look at an audience and think like a DJ and go, well, what should I do now to retain that energy and keep the level up there, keep people interested or keep them on the dance floor or whatever it is? So I'm thinking more about them than I am about myself. And because, I mean, you know, we're kind of accustomed to, as a business, you go, this is an organized set and you play these songs and these songs and these songs in this order and this is the final song and blah, blah, blah. But that's if your world was the same every time. But venues are always different. Crowds are different. People are different. You know, you're different on a certain day. All these factors mean that you should be flexible. And when I play a show, because I love it so much, the live performance, and I want to be interacting with, I don't want to feel chemistry with an audience and a band. So that I never really stick to a regimented set because I go with the emotion. I go with the feeling of the night, whether it's like a terrible night because you've only got a couple of people attending, or whether you've got a great night where your tickets have sold and you've got, you know, hundreds of thousands. I mean, yeah, I've done shows where I've been in stadiums and there's been 150,000 people or something in Rio de Janeiro or São Paulo, I should say. And then I've done shows where I've been at the local pub and there's like been about 3-5 people in there. And, you know, it's kind of the contrast of it is constantly up and down with me. I mean, obviously with the pandemic, we haven't been doing any live shows, but I do remember these times. And the energy level for me has never dropped, whether it was, I mean, I know it's a cliche and people say, yeah, oh, I don't care if there's, you know, two people, you still got to do the best show and blah, blah, blah. But to actually do that, I actually like it when there's less people there because I can see individually what their reactions are. Yeah. I can get honest feedback from those people. And they sometimes talk to you because I might be playing, you know, the local wheel tappers and shunters or whatever. And I'll be kind of, you know, I'll talk to people and they'll say, do you know this tune or whatever? I'll play that tune for me or whatever. Oh, that was rubbish, that. It's kind of, you know, you're getting honest feedback. And I experiment on that night. It's really valuable to me at a night like that. And I test new music. I test new equipment. I test, you know, certain songs. And I love those things, whether they're small or big. And the big ones are those things where you're just like, wow, you know, it's a beautiful, warm night in São Paulo in South America. And, you know, it's like hundreds of thousands of people kind of, you know, all the hands in the air and smiling. And all I can think of is I wish my mom and dad could see me right now.
Yeah.
My friends were here, you know, to kind of join with you and enjoy that same experience, you know, coming from, you know, the Anson council estate and then in a football stadium like that and being that on stage, the center of attraction. It's kind of, you know, it's a
difficult to express, I guess.
Well, there's a warmth to it, you know, a warm feeling inside you of you've arrived and also that what you've accomplished as well, because the work that you put in to get to where you've got to, you really appreciate that then and think the graft you did. And what I mean about that graft and coming back to that point about, you know, the no pain, no gain, those things give you qualities when you work. They give you strengths and foundations, and that's my forte, that I'm not afraid of anything because of those foundations, solid foundations of which I can build on when I'm, for instance, hey, my guitar string snapped. Oh, somebody gave me a toy guitar. Hey, I've only got the, you know, whatever you've got, I can cope because of those foundations of not having anything and knowing that I can. Even if I didn't even have strings, I'd beat the guitar or something, you know, get some beats out of it. Whatever, you know, you do learn that skill set. And so it's a very comforting and confidence building foundation. And when I'm on a big stage like that, you know, I feel strong. I feel, you know, confident because my foundations are solid. And that because that's what it's built on. You know, there's no pretense. Maybe I had though some pretense in getting a job or something, you know. Yeah, I can do that. Yeah, I know how to do it. And you don't. You kind of go home and study afterwards. But the foundations are strong in that sense in me, if there is one thing I can say about myself. And that enjoyment factor, when I enjoyed being in these stages, as you were asking before, that enjoyment is a real warm feeling because I know the work I've put in is hard, you know, good, solid, hard work, which laid down strong foundations. And I'm stood on that stage and I mean, just reaping the benefits of that, shall we say?
Yeah. I mean, are these foundations what drives you to dedicate much of your time to the work you do and mentoring and working with young people, with prisoners and hospice patients? I mean, did you come to the point in life and your career where you wanted to give back and share your skills and musical wisdom, or have you always been involved with like community outreach?
I think it's a difficult one to answer because I don't think I've changed in the way I don't think that now is the only time I ever wanted to give back. I've always felt that, you know, giving is better than receiving. It's just that you can be overpowered with receiving more than you give, just at the pace that works at. But it just later on, you know, after so many experiences and so much experience, really, that people have started to ask me to do things more so, and communication has become stronger, like the internet and social media, that people can reach you more easily than they could before. And when I get asked, it's a kind of a no-brainer that, yeah, of course I would. Why wouldn't I? You know, if I've got the time, I will do it. You know what you want to do, because it's helping somebody else or helping an organization that helps people, or just in general, my opinions on society and how society and the human race in general can get better, even if governments aren't making it easy. I believe in that. I've always believed in that philosophy. So I try to do what I can. But it's just facilitated today, you know, through ease of communication. In the old days, you just did things, but you did them privately. You know, nobody knew that you were doing them, or you just did them as it was on a smaller scale. It's just that now people give you more time of day because of your achievements and so forth. And the offers come in, or people just contact you and say, you know, hey, my daughter, you know, is not well, and she'd really love an autograph on something. You know, if you sent me something from one of the bands, or blah blah blah, you know. Yeah. And that's kind of like, yeah, why not? You know, why can't I do that? Of course I can. You know, sometimes I get a bit lazy. You know, I send something and it doesn't reach, and then I can't be bothered to send it a second time, which is a bit bad. But I think, no, it's always been there with me, that way, knowing, you know, from where I've come from and where I still am, that, you know, I'm in a community here, and it needs people who have privileges and have been fortunate in life, who can maybe do a little bit more, you know, to do, basically, you know, that's all. That giving back, I kind of don't like using that phrase, just because it's such a, it's used so much, and it is a cliche, but sure, I mean, we've all got something to give, you know, it's all relative, you know, I mean, it's relative to, you know, your financial situation, it's relative to the time you have, it's relative to, you know, but to give, and if it's hard to, then, you know, yeah, more kudos to you, you know. But I think that we all do in our different ways. That's all. I've got a certain skill set, and I've got certain advantages. So I see those. I can take advantage of that, my position there, to be able to give like other people are giving. So I don't think that I'm giving any more or anything like that. I just think that where I'm at, and in music, that I know what music does for people. I know how it's affected me and my family and my friends. So I use the music in a good way, as I said, in positive ways, even though I am driven by anger, to tell you the truth. Like I said, you know, that all being stereotypes and so forth angers me, but it drives me in a positive way to achieve more and do more. And then to try and feed that back to people, either in encouragement or support, so that, you know, it doesn't go to waste at the end of the day. What am I going to do? You know, pop my clogs. It's all going to go with me. So, you know, there's a thing about information, you know, that, you know, cells reproduce and they pass on information, you know, through that reproduction. And so knowledge, things like that, you know, I think the East has this thing about word of mouth, and the West has the written, you know, that's kind of history of it. And I like that, the Eastern approach of, you know, sensei and guru and, you know, sifu and, you know, all that kind of thing, ustads and pandits and, you know, passing on information in verbally, because you also need to know the soul of the person and the nature. Pass it on to people who are just not interested, you know, doesn't do any good. But when you see the hunger in people, or the creativity in people, and to share it with them, and you know they're going to do even better than you did, and take it to the next level. That's the way I kind of look at it. That's just want to pass on the knowledge that I've acquired, or experiences, or wherever I've learned, and then pass it on to the next flag bearers, whatever you want to call it.
Well, it's such a good mindset to have, Aziz.
That's down to parents. You know, it's not.
Yeah.
It's just those kind of things that I've been fortunate, you know, that my parents kind of made me feel, you know, made that kind of connection for me with, you know, my feelings, my heart, and that fight between, you know, I don't want to talk about good and evil and right and wrong, but more so about productive kind of things, you know, productivity and. And that's it, really. You know, what I've done or whatever I can do, being productive with those things and giving it to other people for their use and for them to be productive. And mental health and well-being. You know, it all comes from there, I think. You know, people are finding doors for themselves instead of, like, you know, brick walls. And you helping them do that. I kind of struggled when I was young because I didn't have that kind of support from, because my parents can't answer the questions that I was asking, you know, and people didn't know what I was talking about because they weren't in my situation, you know, Muslim, South Asian man, Pakistani or British Pakistan, whatever these labels are, confronted with these situations, and I got questions, nobody to answer them. So I answer them through just picking a direction. But today, you know, you've got people who are unsure, very insecure about things and need answers. And there's lots of organizations that can help. But if I'm working in a prison, for instance, and somebody's actually asking me because they respect the band that I'm from, they love the band. I'm not a politician, and they want to ask my opinion about something or just how I coped with something or how I dealt with something, then it's more kind of, you know, I mean, they respect that more so, I think. Well, as long as what you're saying is not daft, but, you know, I think that makes more sense to them or means more to them than it would from somebody they know is looking for votes. You know, that's about it, really.
Let me ask you a question, because you mentioned being driven by anger, and you sort of mentioned stereotypes and how that was quite a large part of your world when you were coming up in Manchester. Do you think that perhaps English people got themselves into a situation where in the last 20 years since the rave generation, there's racism, if you want to call it that, stereotyping has been hugely on the decline in my generation until such a point where we really are, for all intents and purposes, colorblind and really just don't care about skin color. And now we're told that, oh no, you must care about skin color, and we've kind of been caught wrong-footed, and things are coming to the fore, and stories like your own have got a resonance. But I believe that certain people in my generation are stuck in this place of, you know, in the rave generation, we grew up and it was kind of instilled into us that with all those racism, it's just ridiculous, you know, don't do it. And it's cool to be cool, and it doesn't matter what color you are, what sexual identity you are or whatever. What's your thoughts on this kind of new era of we must put an emphasis on skin color?
Well, I mean, it's a complicated subject, you know. It's such a grey area. It was clearer for me in the 70s and 80s because it was kind of, you know, you saw the National Front coming.
Yeah.
You know, and it was violence at the end of the day. But yeah, things do get clever. You know, it's sometimes they don't go away. They're just underground. They're just a bit more hidden, like in the workspace and so forth. And it occasionally comes out, like we're seeing today currently with the cricket, you know, that didn't suddenly just come about, you know, about Yorkshire cricket and cricket in general. It was always there, you know, and it just come to a head. It couldn't be ignored. So it's always there at the end of the day. It's not gone away. There's more control, but obviously PC becomes almost like bureaucracy in a way, you know. It becomes overpowering, and it does kind of, you know, you feel like you haven't got the freedoms to speak and you haven't got the freedoms to talk. And but at the same time, you know, it was wrong in terms of programming, like with the BBC and ITV and so forth, you know, the way that programs like Rising Damp and Bless This House and, you know, Mind Your Language and Ain't Half Hot Mum, you know, these programs were just wrong, you know, in their approach. Absolutely wrong. And not just, I'm not just talking about color, you know, I'm talking about gender as well, and about sexual orientation and so forth. And these are all issues that needed addressing, and it's taken a long time to address them. And that's where we're at today. But that doesn't mean that they've gone away. And we have, it's confusing as well. But, you know, it's very confusing half the time. You know, I mean, even I'm guilty of saying things that I used to say in like the 70s and 80s and things, and, you know, and finding myself like, you know, it's wrong to say that, wrong to use that phrase and so forth. And, but it, just dealing with it, I think is right, because I find that, you know, attitudes need to change in a lot of respects regarding gender, racism, sexuality, so forth. And we're being forced in a sense that we can't use certain phrases and so forth. But what is making things difficult is the way that social media changes or groups people together, the way these algorithms work, how it brings people together, how it seems like you're in a majority and others in a minority, and how this is okay and this isn't, and advertising, how those, because these algorithms are about money, are about advertising, marketing and so forth. So, you know, like with politicians, you know, politicians are getting away with saying quite racist things, sexist things, homophobic things, and they blatantly get away with it. No repercussion. Almost unashamedly, in fact. You know, it's like the internet became this thing where it was about shaming, naming and shaming. And now people are growing thick skins that they don't even care that they're being named or shamed. So, you know, society, as in relationship to its digital world, it's that is going a pretty dark direction, I feel. I know I haven't answered your question directly.
That's all right. It's a difficult one.
There's so many areas here that, you know, we could talk about. That my experience of that racism, it's always been there. Because don't forget, these are just perspectives. You know, your perspective, my perspective. You know, when people say to me that I don't think of color, or I never look at people in terms of color, you know, to me, that is almost wrong. It is wrong. You know, if you can't see the color of my skin, acknowledge that. If you can't see that I speak another language, there's something wrong there, you know.
But what about, sure, you're going to notice the color of someone's skin.
Of course you are.
It's whether you prejudge them on that observation.
Prejudgment. What is prejudgment? I mean, are you talking about I see the color of your skin, and or I see, you know, a gender or something, and you think questions in your head about, you know, or the color of skin, are they African, are they Caribbean, are they such and such a place, blah blah blah, you know. I mean, I won't call it a judgment, but they're questions that you have, or interest that you have, let's say. You know, there's so many factors here that, you know, you got to draw a line between and say that, you know, I'm not prejudging somebody, but you're interested in knowing more. But yeah, because you can see that, you know, who they are, what they are, or not entirely who they are or what they are, but there's a beginning there. And to say that, you know, I don't I know what somebody means by that. They're trying to say, I'm not racist, you know. But I don't think that phrase, for instance, that doesn't work for me personally. You know, I don't see, you know, colour. I don't see. You do see colour. Everyone sees colour. Well, not everybody sees colour. But if you're capable of, your eyes are capable of it, you do see it.
What about if you observe it, but you give so little heed to the colour of someone's skin rather than the content of their character that it's insignificant in your interaction with them?
Well, to the person whose colour it is, to some, it's not significant. They don't want it to be significant. They want to blend in. We're all different. Mm. Just because we're a particular colour doesn't make us the same. So therefore, our opinions are different. So you talk to one person and he'll go, yeah, I want you to see the colour of my skin. I want you to see everything about me so you recognise my individuality, my identity. Another person would say, I don't want to be different. I want to be like everybody else. I want to blend in. I want my work to be the thing you judge me on. Completely different perspective, because all these different cultures, in my opinion, I mean, bear in mind, this is only my opinion, that in each culture are millions and billions of people, all different, different identities, different individuals who have different perspectives. So you can't generalize, races. You can't generalize genders and generalize anything, because we've all got different perspectives and you have to respect that. So I think to say that, you know, you don't see, you know, the color of skin or the, you know, anything else, I think you got to give people room to share what they want to share about themselves in the way that they want to. If they want to talk about that and being different because they, you know, they're proud of it, or they you know, they relish it, or just in general, it's, you know, it's their identity or their culture, or part of their culture. You have to recognize that without ignoring that completely and saying, I mean, we do, for instance, we're talking about music, and we have been talking about music, and that's the culture in which you and I have related. I like that relationship, you know, that my culture, my country is music, and it kind of supersedes borders and countries, you know, barriers and passports,
nationalities, and yeah,
all that thing. You know, the music is the key factor through which we relate. But saying that, I still, you know, can recognize some, you know, a different gender, or know that somebody's, you know, sexuality is different to mine, or so, and still respect it at the same time, but recognize it, you know. That doesn't mean I'm disrespecting them. It doesn't mean that I'm judging them. It just means I recognize it. There's an equilibrium here for me personally, that I like to, where I like to sit. But I don't really like that phrase about, I don't see color, and I don't see, you know, I don't, you know, judge you based upon anything like that. Well, I mean, that's all well and good, but, you know, recognize that person's culture, identity, there are so many facets to it, and we're all different. So,
and they're all individual to them.
Yeah, we're all individuals. So respect.
So there's hardly any point in categorizing people, as you say. You can't just lump people into under one heading or under another heading, or one label, another label, because everybody synthesizes their own experience in a different way. And that experience does, in fact, come out in the content of your character and your actions and the things you say and the things you do, yeah, and your interactions with people. And those are the things that I'm really interested in. I'm primarily interested in how people move in the world on an individual basis, and then how they interact with other humans. And
you know, I mean, it's fascinating. I mean, you know, the interaction for me personally is fascinating. I mean, in music, in the industry, I've come across so much racism that, you know, it's appalling. But at the same time, I'm kind of fascinated by it, that how music can segregate people, you know, like football in the sense, you know, which team you support, which musical genre you like. And I've never been that way orientated, because it all had something to teach me, and I just love different genres for what they, the qualities of those genres that I felt were different to the others. But that relationship in music, you know, I mean, we all know it, you know, the bias in terms of what people think is great and what they think is shit, and you know what they think is, you know, that everyone's got an opinion, you know, I'm entitled to it, great,
yeah,
you know, fine. But it does fascinate me, that kind of, I don't know, it's almost like a superiority complex into other genres and so forth. And I've just drifted in through genre to genre, because I want to enjoy them all. I really do enjoy them all. And I work a lot.
How dare you with your cultural appropriation disease?
Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, cultural appropriation, you know. If you want to talk about cultural appropriation, I mean, you really get down to it and you think about any person that plays the blues. Isn't that culturally appropriate?
Keith Richards, there you go.
And then if you look at it in that perspective and you look at every musician who plays the blues, and you're thinking, okay, so you're emulating black music or black musicians or singing, for instance, and pick any program and the singing is, you know, in the vein of black music, if it's based on those blues scales and it's based on jazz and so forth. And you know, you could take it there, you know, you talk about cultural appropriation, but I mean, that one thing is what I've been exploring with my projects with the Arts Council. You know, when I got a little bit of funding, I'd be able to explore identity, and I do believe that music is for everyone to enjoy. If you love the blues, then enjoy it. You want to play like so-and-so, play like so-and-so. You know, you want to be Stevie Ray Vaughan, or Stevie Ray Vaughan wanted to be, you know, his heroes, which would have been, you know, Howling Wolf, T-Bone Walker, and Muddy Waters, and so forth. And and B.B. King, and blah, blah, blah. But I've tried to reverse engineer myself in that sense, that I wonder what, you know, if I want to be true to my identity, which isn't just culturally from South Asia, because my parents are from South Asia. And bearing in mind, my parents have changed identity from Indian to Pakistani to British. Mm. Oh, so when people say, oh, you're from Pakistan, it's like, well, not really, because my parents were originally from India. And then Pakistan only formed, and Bangladesh, which was the only country to have independence twice, which was East Pakistan and then Bangladesh, has its own, you know, identity in terms of people born, unless they were born to that side of Bengal, they haven't moved. But Bengal in itself, you know, split, Punjab in itself split, and then being here and being told I'm British Pakistani is like, well, I'm not sure. I know I'm British with my passport. My parents' heritage is Pakistani, but before that it was Indian. So it's always fascinated me, this thing about identity. And then music came into it, and I thought, what if I was never to play a blues scale? What if I was never to play black music as such, you know, the origins and roots of it? If I was to look at it in terms of music before the British came to India or the continent, subcontinent, you know, before that 400 years of rule, before the East India Company came in 1600, what would music be like? How would I be playing music? What would be my train of thought? What would be the scales I would use? And what would be the melodies? Or would it be rags? Or my parents are from the Punjab, and I had a DNA test, and it said that, you know, 95% of my DNA comes from that region or from the North India, then, you know, what's my kind of school of thought? Because, I mean, if you look at music, you know, most people think of music in terms of black and white notes on a piano, you know, 12-note system that repeats itself. Well, culturally, my ears are attuned to quarter notes, an eighth note. The influence of the Arabic invaders, you know, or from the Afghan invaders or the Persian invaders, Mughals and so forth. You know, it's like they've all brought different their cultures with them and influenced the subcontinent society. When I hear music or listen to music, I don't hear those notes as being out of tune. You know, they're notes, they're quarter notes, they're eighth notes. But somebody whose ears are accustomed to black and white notes, you know, it's very regimented and set that those notes are either out of tune or it's into the vein of the blues, maybe, because tension notes in blues are quarter notes. I mean, that's what I believe. So it fascinates me again, you know, and interests me that if I tried not to culturally appropriate music, you know, which we all do it, that I find that, okay, let me try playing music without employing certain scales for a start, and not playing chords in that way. That's where my mind has been at for years, but I've never implemented it into the Roses. But obviously, I was, you know, doing the Roses. But my material of late and music I've written over decades has been in that vein of finding my own identity in my music, and trying to reverse engineer a lot of the things which are cultural appropriation. Musically, lyrically, scales and so forth, progressions and composition. There's a lot of cultural appropriation there. I mean, look at great hits in the charts and musically, you know, there's cultural appropriation of no recognition or taken publicizing your idea and concept of what, say, maybe Indian music is and the way that the Beatles or the Stones or Led Zepp, you know, how they culturally appropriated music and put that into their material and taken from or blatantly copied from black musicians and their albums. You know, there's a whole history of it. If you really knew your music, you could name the albums and songs where they just, you know, in this day and age of people saying copyright, you know, that's another thing we could talk, you know, for hours and hours about copyright. Why isn't that copyright law there for all the black musicians and the, you know, the music that's been stolen from them? But I mean,
are we saying ultimately that cultural appropriation in music is not only inevitable, but it's the source, it's the blood that runs in the veins. If you don't act like a magpie and pick up things that ring your bell, then you're not going to get the best out of your talents.
Well, I can see the conversation where it's going to go, because, I mean, obviously, people listening to this will be thinking about, well, where do you draw the line between influence and cultural appropriation, you know? And
what's the difference?
I was talking more so about just copying somebody's song, you know, or somebody's music, which is what used to happen. And it still happens now. It's just that some people understand copyright law really well and like people understand taxation really well and maneuver themselves around it.
Because cultural appropriation is kind of wrapped up in people's minds with skin color. But you could say, is a black English person rapping?
Yeah.
Culturally appropriating. American. Yeah,
it's not a skin color, but it's just that most of the time you see a person, a majority, and that again, we're generalizing. Just as you have white Jamaicans, you know, you have, you know, or so forth, or you have, you know, Pakistani Christians, or, you know, again, we're generalizing and we shouldn't do that.
Yeah, but, I agree.
And it comes back to that subject of today, where we are today about, you know, PC and, you know, what is correct and what isn't. Can we say these things? Can we not? But I mean, I think the biggest divide for me was I just wanted to see if I could separate myself from what I knew was a Western influence for me, and that Western influence being taken from music that has come from African Americans. And I think the growth of that music is a history in itself and a history of people in different cultures. But I know where my parents' heritage is from, and I kind of wanted to explore that influence on me more so because it's been ignored at school and it's been ignored, you know, in the history books. The history that I was taught is not the history that I've become to, that I've learned recently, you know, because of the nature of the internet and not information being available to you very quickly. So I'm just exploring that. And I find that cultural appropriation doesn't even come into it once I start to lose a lot of the music that I've learnt from Western bands and from not just Western bands, but that music still comes full circle back to African American. And I kind of wanted to know more about, I wanted to know about other countries, basically. I wanted to know about how, you know, music is created, the thought processes behind them. But that doesn't mean that I want to disrespect the people that are the originators of that music, the cultures where that music comes from. You know, I wouldn't want to do that kind of thing. And I make it really obvious that this comes from a particular place. But my love of that music from that culture is where my, you know, my pursuits are, really. I mean, that's probably the best way I can describe it. Because, I mean, I explore music from, you know, Korea and Japan and China, Taiwan, Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh. And each region in itself has its own form of music and so forth. And, you know, I'm like, that's probably coming back to the very first thing we were speaking about, was about my, you know, culture and identity playing a part in who I am, or being publicized. And I think for that reason, I do that. And I say that, you know, this is how I identify myself. But my love of music and respect for music and where it comes from, I want to, I want that that music influences me in my songwriting and creation. But this is where I've come from and where I'm at, and working in collaboration. I hate the word fusion. I'm not, and I think it's such an 80s kind of term. You know, that keep these South Asian musicians in their place. They can only play this jazz rock field and so forth. And, you know, it was a great era of some great musicians, but, you know, we are so diverse in the forms of music that we make, that it's not fusion anymore. You know, it's not fusion. Some people will stick to that term and will use that term, but I think music has so many diverse genres, and so do people from the East, from South Asia, Southeast Asia, Africa, wherever. Diverse forms of music, they don't come under the same banner just because it has an influence of their heritage in there. You got to think about the songs and what the lyrics are saying. It's not fusion. It's statements. What music, what art is, you know.
I love the way you think so deeply about these things, and
maybe too deeply.
Well, that's the way you were built, though. So
yeah, the questions arise from being British. They arise from being born in a council estate. They arise from living in Manchester, and therefore it means it probably should be the same, or maybe it's the same for everyone everywhere. You know, that when you're confronted with these questions, or you have to answer them for yourself. You know, I mean, I've been in situations, Danny, where I just kind of, people are asking me, well, who are you, or what are you, and shouldn't you be this, and shouldn't you that, or you're not allowed to do this, are you, and blah, blah, blah. So I had to ask myself those questions and go, why? Why am I not? Why do I this? And why am I more comfortable here? And why am I that? You know, the questions are there. And I want to answer those questions, and only through this kind of work, or, you know, like working with the Arts Council, you know, has given me an opportunity to do just that, and not just sit in that kind of rock and roll chair and throw TVs out of hotel room windows, you know.
I don't know, Aziz. I mean, I've always taken the mindset that, from my personal point of view, anybody that says to me, that gives me kind of some kind of presumption of my character and says, listen, you're not allowed to get into that area, and you're not allowed to do this, you should be doing that, I just like, fuck off.
I'm like I said, you
and
know,
I don't give it much more thought, and I think deeply about many things, and like you, I overthink and I agonize and I ruminate, but I can spot an arsehole and people that just need to do one.
Yeah, I mean, it's not even about other people for me. People do stereotype me and say, like you've mentioned, and they'll say that, well, you know, you people are only good at badminton and cricket and playing, you know, classical or Bhangra. And I'm like, yeah, those are great qualities to have, personally, I think. But, you know, I play rugby and basketball and play the guitar and, you know, I love Bhangra. But I like loads of genres of music, so that's
it's,
me.
I don't know. It's the same, isn't it? There's probably loads of white kids in and Asian kids actually in America and England that really wanted to be a rapper, you know, when it all came about, and just got told, no, you can't do that because of the hard coded characteristic about yourself. You know, you're not going to cut the mustard, and it's just not true, is it? I mean, and we all know it's not true. Talent is talent. Skill is skill. And Dr. Dre is going to work with Eminem as sure he is going to work with Snoop Dogg. And you've got the personality and the talent and the skill and the profile to have worked with some of the best we've got in the music world. And that's nothing to do with the hard-coded characteristic of your skin color or the ancestral legacy of your parents. That is Aziz Ibrahim, the man, the machine, the guitarist, you know.
Yeah, well, I mean, as we were saying before, yeah, you know, sometimes it's just about, you know, the work you do and the friendships.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
Do you people want to hang out? You know, do you want to hang out with them? It's just friendships and work sometimes, and you know, and should be, you know. But you know, the other factors they're just a part of you, they make up who you are, and they, you know, come to surface every so often. So but the fact that people respect you, you know, and you respect them, you know, that's the kind of relationship that where I want to be. And I always said that, you know, it's always been about equality, just an equality, being respected and respecting back.
Well, I can guarantee you are respected. I mean, my friends were just made up when I mentioned to them that I got the opportunity to speak to you. So because of your work and your character and the things that you've done in your career, you've got respect from all angles, mate. But listen, I've really enjoyed talking to you, Aziz.
It's been long.
It's been a really good long chat, and you've given me a lot of food for thought. But just before I'll let you go. Tell us what's in store for us next. What are you going to give us next in terms of your next project?
What I'm trying to do at the moment is run several projects at the same time.
Oh.
I think it's time to step up the game, really. I think I've been really complacent, and then the pandemic has really made me think long and hard. I didn't fare well through the pandemic, and I don't just mean financially. I struggled with my mental health and well-being in general.
You're not alone, mate. You're not alone.
Yeah, I think a lot of people did. But for me, because I've always been that kind of person where people have depended upon my consistency and reliability, and from when I fell short of that, it worried a lot of people that build, as I said, you know, you build your strengths based on strong foundations. And if you're a foundation for others, then their kind of scaffolding starts to topple.
Yeah, well said.
And I recovered fairly quickly, just if it wasn't just for that, really. But out of it, I found that I embraced digital and I kind of embraced technology and about the good points about it. And I've been working to upload music more often or start writing more and uploading more often and working in a digital way. So then I found that I'm not as efficient as I could be. So I thought that I'm working with different friends and people, and I thought, why can't I handle more projects and just be more efficient in terms of the release and finishing the products, you know, finishing things and the efficiency in which I work. I've been working at those, I've been working at process really, you know. But in the same time, I'm also learning about content creation and like yourself, you know, learning from podcasters and YouTubers and gamers and broadcasters and about the future and how music is consumed and how I can reach people better in the way that I release music and video. So it's such a an exciting time for me right now. I'm working with different partners like Richard Barbieri from, if you remember, from Japan, and also from Porcupine Tree. We're writing an epic with Gavin Harrison on drums, and we're hoping to have that released soon. I'm writing a lot of solo material, some instrumental. I'm putting all my legacy material up as well. I'm working with Lancashire County Council as a musician in residence across Helmshaw Mill, Clitheroe Castle, Queen Street Mill, and Helmshaw Textile Mill, I mentioned before, and Gawthorpe Hall in Padiham as musician in residence. So I'm kind of pushing, pioneering these kind of, instead of artists in residence, musician in residence projects to kind of encourage people, musicians to apply, you know, for funding that is available to artists to work in heritage sector or things like that, or museums and libraries. And it doesn't just have to be poets and book writers and artists. Working that sector a lot. And this year has been a project of that project, Musician in Residence. My project is Sound of Heritage. What does heritage sound like? I find very challenging. And one of the things I've been doing is to actually record impulse responses to capture spaces that may or may not be there in the future, like beautiful halls and castles and the sounds of them, so that your ears tell you that you're in that space. And creating an archive, digital archives, that Heritage and Learning Lancashire will have available in Preston from the archives, digital archives they have there, or different places. Preserving audio, you know, why not? We preserve everything else. So, because I'm an audio guy, so that's what my mind thinks. But it's been beautiful working on that project. I'm working on other things as well. I'm on the board of trustees for Mossad Millennium Powerhouse and for the Olympias Music Foundation in Longsight. Still doing, you know, various forms of work, but musically, new releases. I work with the Guitar Collective, which is the South Asian and Southeast Asian collective, guitarists, mainly musicians, sharing ideas, supporting each other through Facebook group page, encouraging, you know, the growth of guitar music across the whole of the East. So, and I use my skill set and my experience and obviously what I've achieved in the West and mainstream, Western mainstream, to kind of share that knowledge in the Guitar Collective, to help the younger ones pursue, you know, their musical careers or just music in general. There's a few things, shall we say, in the pipe.
It sounds like it. As per usual, you're putting it about. You're a busy man. People can keep up with these different tentacles that you've got all over the place at the perfectly named website aziz.co.uk, aziz.co.uk.
I think better still, if you just Google Aziz Ibrahim and put Stone Roses or Simply Red, you know, usual suspects into Google, then all my social media comes up, and I think you can find, you know, pick your poison, really.
Yeah, quite. Inside,
as you said, thank you.
Well, thanks for coming on the podcast, Aziz. And that's it for another episode of the Infinite Jigsaw podcast. Until next time, thank you, listeners, for listening. Please do get in touch via comment or email. And thank you again for my guest for today. Cheers, Aziz. It's been a real pleasure.
Cheers, Danny.
All right, mate. Ta-ra.